والله يدعو إلى دار السلام ويهدي من يشاء إلى صراط مستقيم.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Welcome to a new episode of your program, The Rope That Binds Us, As-Sunnah and Al-Jama'ah. All praise due to Allah and His blessings and peace be upon His Prophet Muhammad and all the prophets and the messengers and their followers until the Day of Judgment. I bear witness that He is the only one worthy of worship, and Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is His last and final messenger. My dear brothers and sisters, in the last episode, we discussed the issue of respecting and honoring the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's sunnah and the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and we mentioned some of the evidence that support this issue and shows the importance of showing all kind of respect and honoring to the hadith, to the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And we also said what Al-Qadhi Iyad have said in his book Al-Shifa, that these rules are not only related to the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam when he was alive, it also applied to his sunnah after his death. That's why you'll see the scholars mention so many details related to this issue, such as they said, from respecting and honoring the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that his name will not be mentioned in a time where people are not paying attention to the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And people, when they hear the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's name been mentioned, they should say sallallahu alaihi wasallam. To the extent the scholars said, some scholars said, it's not allowed for you when you write his name to say sal or sala or sad, abbreviation for sallallahu alaihi wasallam, because this is not the way to show your respect and your honoring to the Prophet. The muhaddithin, the science of the scholars of hadith, what they used to do when they write the hadith, they will leave a space in between the words. When they said the Prophet said, they will see leave a space, and after they finish the class, they go back and fill the space with sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They will pronounce it, but they will not write it because there is no time. To that extent, Imam Malik also, one of the scholars who used to take shower before he goes to the class of hadith to teach the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who will prefer wudu before narrating any hadith. Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah, when he collected his book Sahih al-Bukhari, he said, I used to make wudu, perfect wudu, and I will pray 2 rak'ah before I will report any hadith in my book. They used to treat the book of hadith with respect because it has the statements of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Once an imam or a scholar visited al-Hijaz, Mecca and Medina during the Hajj. So the students asked al-Imam Malik, should we go and learn from him, listen to his ahadith and what he's teaching? Al-Imam Malik said, wait. And he went and he listened to him. Then he came back and said, no. Next year, the same scholar came, or years later, he came to al-Hijaz for Hajj. Then the students asked the same question to Imam Malik. He went and he listened to him. Then he came back and he said, now you can go study under that Shaykh. You know why? Because he said, the first time I saw him, he was asked, why you change your opinion? He said, the first time when I saw him, years ago or last year, he said, when he said the Prophet ﷺ said, he used to say it like any other statement, as if there is no difference between what the Prophet ﷺ said or what any other person said. But this year when I heard him, before he said the Prophet said, I can tell that he think a lot about the statement before saying it, that he shows so much respect to this statement before even pronouncing the Prophet ﷺ's name. You can tell that his face changed, his position changed, out of respect and taking this issue very seriously. Now, Imam Malik thinks that he is ready to teach and he deserves to be the teacher of his students. This attitude, you will only find it on the people, in the people who follow the way of the Prophet ﷺ, the way of the early Muslim generations. That's why I would like just to mention very quickly the position of Ahlul Bid'ah, the people of innovation, towards the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ. Al-Imam Ibn al-Qasim, one of the great imams, said, you will never find any innovator unless you will never find any innovator unless you see it, it's over there. You will never find any innovator unless he disrespects the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, even if he claims that he honors him sallallahu alaihi wasallam, even if he claims that he honors him sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Al-Imam al-Awza'i, one of the great imam, also said, any innovator, if you narrate a hadith which opposes his innovation, but he feels dislike towards the hadith, that's what he feels immediately. Another imam, his name, Ibn al-Qattan, said, there is no innovator in the world but who hates Ahlul Hadith, the people who narrate the hadith. When a person innovates, immediately, the sweetness of hadith will be stripped away from his heart. Stripped away from his heart. That's why you see the innovator always like to talk about other than the sunnah. They are so ignorant about the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That's why the first point I can mention about Ahlul Bid'ah towards the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam hadith, what I call simple ignorance. Simple ignorance. Simple ignorance, I mean by that, that they don't know the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. They don't know it. That's why Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah, for example, said about one of the well-known scholars in his time, even they used to call him the Imam of the two Harams, Mecca and Medina, Imam al-Haramain. He said when you read the books that this person wrote, you will realize that this person, he never read Al-Bukhari and Muslim. He never been exposed to these two books, which is the basic books in Hadith. Even though when he talk also, he comment on Al-Ghazali, Abu Hamid Al-Ghazali, in his book, Ihya Ulum al-Din, he said, the Hadith will be in Al-Bukhari or Muslim, and he will quote a Hadith from a reference which is not common or even not known. Or he will narrate the Hadith from a way which is has a liar, or it will be judged as fabricated, and the same meaning narrated by Al-Bukhari or Muslim, that shows you that he is not familiar with the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But we're not suggesting here that this person or that person is innovator or not. It's not about judging the person, it's just about giving an example of what I mean by simple ignorance. That basically the person doesn't know the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam or the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Sometimes it's double ignorance, that the person will narrate a hadith to support his view or his idea, and he doesn't know that it is fabricated or weak, or not even a hadith, or not even a hadith, and that's what I call double ignorance. Also, you will find them sometimes disrespect the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You will see some of the leaders of Al-Mu'tazila, Ibn Thalji and others, who used to, Al-Jammaz, they used to mention the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they used to mention the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's names with the people who are people who are not worthy of mentioning their names with an honorable individual. So what about the Prophet ﷺ? That you mentioned the Prophet ﷺ with one of this poet who used to say indecent words or indecent lines, it's not a respectful way of treating the Prophet ﷺ. And there will be, inshallah, more example to explain their positions toward the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ. Before I mention these two examples I have for you, I just want to make sure that we remember simple ignorance, but by not knowing the hadith. That's why you will see books written, hundreds of pages, There is no single hadith in it. And sometimes it's double ignorance. When they mention a hadith, it will be either fabricated or very weak, or they will quote a statement said by some of the scholars and attribute this to the Prophet ﷺ, or they will say, this hadith reported by al-Bukhari and it's not in al-Bukhari. Or they said this hadith reported by one of unknown or not common books in hadith, and the hadith itself exists in al-Bukhari and Muslim. That are called double ignorance. Also disrespect whenever they found a hadith go against what they believe, they will not hesitate to reject the hadith or even to make fun of those who narrate the hadith. Opposing and rejecting the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ. A good example, it's not good, but a good example to express my point or to prove my point with, what Amr ibn Ubayd said in regard to the hadith which is reported by al-Bukhari and others, that Ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu arda said, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said so and so. Anyway, without going to details, when Amr ibn Ubayd was told about this hadith, he said, if the student of Ibn Mas'ud narrated this hadith directly to me, so here is not about he doubt the narrator, maybe there is a mistake. He said, if he narrated this to me straight, I will not accept it. And he said, if I meet Ibn Mas'ud personally, and Ibn Mas'ud will tell me, I heard the Prophet ﷺ saying that, I will reject what Ibn Mas'ud narrating. And if I meet the Prophet ﷺ, here there is nobody in between him and the Prophet. He said, if I meet the Prophet ﷺ, or I hear the Prophet ﷺ saying such statement, I will not take it from him. A'udhu billah. Even he went farther by saying, and if I hear this statement directly from Allah, I will oppose to that. I will say, oh Allah, this is not fair. A'udhu billah. Yes, it can reach to that level that they can reject the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ to that extent. Another example, Al-Jahm ibn Safwan. Al-Jahm ibn Safwan was born in the time of the in the beginning of the third generation of Islam. And in that era, in that time, narrating the hadith was something so common. He was in a time where the scholar of hadith, where so many of them exist in his town, in his time. But guess what? We don't have a single narration for Al-Jahm ibn Safwan in the Sunnah. He never narrated a single hadith. Why? Because he doesn't care about it. They used to make fun of the scholars of hadith, and they have no interest actually to learn about the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ. It's one of the way of the innovators. It's not the way of Ahlul Sunnah that they show any kind of disrespect or they're careless about the Prophet ﷺ Sunnah. But the way of the early Muslim scholars and those who want to follow their footsteps, the way to bring all of us together, that we always show respect and honoring to the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ. And as so many of the Muslim scholars said, if you hear a hadith, you can't understand it, or it's difficult for you sometimes to understand it, don't rush to rejecting it, but accept it. Or wait until you see somebody who can explain it to you in a better way. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us among those who respect the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and his sunnah. And I will see you inshallah in the next episode.